So, people want to go to Mars. But there's a lot of challenges that we need to overcome to do that. These issues are being studied all around the world, by everyone from scientists to everyday space enthusiasts who have access to animation software. One of the elements that turns up most often, especially online, is artificial gravity. While there is definitely academic research being done on this, there's also tons of concepts being posted online by people who are a bit less qualified. Don't get me wrong, curiosity is great, and I'm not willing to call myself an expert. I've just noticed a couple things that are often overlooked in these designs. This video is really just looking to educate, honestly, a couple hundred people about the stability of rotating bodies and why that's so important to artificial gravity. Before we start, I just want to acknowledge that most of these concepts are using SpaceX's Starship. Successful landings or not, this is currently the only Mars rocket that's seeing real, active hardware development, so it's natural to consider Starship when we're talking about missions to Mars. Also, it was just announced while I was writing this that SpaceX has been selected as the sole contractor for the early Artemis landings. This lunar landing contract came with $2.89 billion, which is definitely going to speed up development. Either way, the concepts I'm talking about today can be applied to a variety of Mars vehicles. Let's face it, if you've somehow stumbled on this video, you're probably already familiar with artificial gravity. But just in case, I'll do a quick rundown. Objects want to travel in a straight line at constant velocity. If you apply a force, that will accelerate them, changing their direction and their speed. To move an object in a circle, you have to provide constant acceleration. Imagine swinging a bucket, you have to constantly pull on the handle to accelerate it. As described by Einstein, the gravity we experience on Earth is basically indistinguishable from a constant upward acceleration. In other words, spinning something can make it feel like it's experiencing gravity on the surface of a planet. This artificial gravity could be extremely useful in helping to combat many of the side effects of space travel, including muscle and bone loss, as well as blood redistribution and increased pressure in your eyes. My university has actually done a study on that last one using a very small centrifuge. Unfortunately, while they were able to restore blood pressure to standing levels, they weren't able to decrease the pressure in the eyes, so, as always, more research is needed. But either way, it's widely believed that rotational artificial gravity is capable of helping with many of the side effects of space travel. Actually, one final tangent, because I can't just throw this up and not mention it. People hate short-radius centrifuges. Seriously, the comments on this video are legitimately furious about this being a waste of university funds. I could do a whole video on this topic. In fact, I had to delete about a page of the script when I realized this was supposed to be a tangent. But long story short, motion sickness tends to get worse with a shorter radius. You can adapt to a constant rotation, but when you turn your head, the direction of rotation changes, there's some gyroscopic effects which can create something called the cross-coupled illusion. You feel like you're moving in a way that you aren't actually moving, so this affects your balance, and of course it can make you sick. This is related to the Coriolis effect, and I'd recommend checking out Tom Scott's video where he's throwing things in a spinning room. Like I said, this is supposed to be a tangent, so I don't really have time to talk about that. And don't worry, if you want to finish this video first, I'll remind you at the end of it to check out Tom's video. The good news is that you can adapt to all of this. Most of the arguments against short radius centrifuges are using data from the general population for their motion sickness thresholds. But just like every other part of your body, your inner ear can be trained. The same researcher who developed this centrifuge also developed a program that allowed people to adapt to high rates of rotation. Before the experiment, the average participant was feeling the cross-coupled illusion around 1.8 RPMs. But after the experiment, that was increased to 17 RPMs. To explain just how significant that is, the first number suggests a radius of 500 meters, and the second gets us closer to 5. That means you can take a system that would be a kilometer long and shrink it to 10 meters. And the training wasn't that extreme, it was just 10 days, with 25-minute sessions where they would move their heads back and forth while spinning. So I may be a bit biased because I do like this professor, but I believe that short-radius centrifuges are severely overlooked. They are way more practical for today's applications. But with that said, let's throw the short-radius centrifuge out and talk about the big boys, where the entire spacecraft is rotating and creating constant artificial gravity. And right off the bat, I'm also going to throw out ring stations. You're right, they're cool, but they're also huge and heavy and require tons of launches. We could add short radius rings to something like an Aldrin cycler, but in that case it would probably be more cost effective to do dumbbells, especially if the crew is small. But most of the concepts I'm talking about don't require a separate ship to get you to Mars, they just rotate an entire starship. A single starship can rotate on its own to produce artificial gravity, or multiple ships can connect together and increase the radius using a tether or a truss. So let's start with the simple ones where a single starship is rotating, and I'll be honest, it's not super practical. You see, Starship is designed to land upright on Mars, so all of the equipment on board, including chairs and beds and computers, ecosystems, they're all oriented for humans that are standing like this. But there's no way to rotate a single Starship and produce gravity in this direction. Rotation around the short axis creates artificial gravity in the opposite direction, and rotation about the long axis creates artificial gravity perpendicular to what it should be on Mars. That means you either need twice the equipment, or the equipment has to rotate. Neither option is ideal, they're both going to add weight and complexity. The short axis also has massive gravity gradient issues. We don't know exactly where the center of gravity is going to fall on a completed starship, but it's safe to say there's not going to be a whole lot of acceleration here, and there will be all the way out here. Now that could be useful, because it would simulate various environments, so you have a deck that's the Moon, one that's Mars, and one that's the Earth. The long axis rotation doesn't have this problem, because it doesn't have multiple floors. But it has a much worse issue, and no, it's not motion sickness. Let's talk about rotational stability. In space, you can spin something up, and it will spin forever. Sort of. You see, the angular momentum, including the direction and magnitude, will be constant. But that doesn't mean that the rate of rotation is constant, or even the axis of rotation relative to the vehicle. Angular momentum is a combination of your angular velocity and your moment of inertia, the same way that normal momentum is a combination of your linear velocity and your mass. The moment of inertia describes how hard it is to rotate something. A 30-pound dumbbell isn't as hard to rotate as a 30-pound barbell, despite having the same mass. But objects don't have a single moment of inertia. If I try to twist the barbell like this, it's suddenly much easier. This is because the moment of inertia is itself a combination of mass and distance, specifically the distance from the axis of rotation. When I was trying to rotate it this way, the weights were far from the axis, but they were much closer to the second axis. That means the second axis has a lower moment of inertia. You can force objects to rotate around any axis, but in space they're going to naturally rotate around their center of mass. In that case, objects can be simplified to only three moments of inertia. There's an axis with the maximum moment of inertia, one with the minimum moment of inertia, and a third axis that's perpendicular to both of those according to the right-hand rule, and it has a moment of inertia somewhere in between. Generally speaking, objects tend to move towards lower energy states. And rotational kinetic energy is half of the moment of inertia times the angular velocity squared. That means that while angular momentum is constant, an object will try to reduce its energy by spinning around the maximum moment of inertia. I'll demonstrate this with a water bottle, by spinning around the axis with the minimum moment of inertia. When I drop it, the sloshing of the water inside the bottle wastes the rotational energy, and by the time it hits the ground, it's starting to rotate around its maximum moment of inertia. And if it spent enough time spinning in space, it would end up rotating purely around that maximum moment of inertia. This means that we sort of have to throw this concept out, because the sloshing of the fuel in the tanks and the air in the cabin will eventually destabilize it. So that's about it for single starship concepts. Now let's move on to the multi-ship ideas, starting with the Small Stars Gravity Link Starship. My first impression was that this is a bit overcomplicated. There's three ships, and hinges and trusses, all so you can use the main engines while you're spinning. I don't think that's really necessary, because most of the flight to Mars is just floating through space with a couple of corrective maneuvers. But let's give it the benefit of the doubt and look at the rotational stability. At first, you might think this is the maximum moment of inertia, it's like the barbell. But it's actually the third ship in the middle that's a bit of an issue. If we zoom in, it's rotating around the axis with the minimum moment of inertia, not the maximum, That means that the actual maximum moment of inertia is around this axis. And of course, this axis is the minimum moment of inertia, which means that the whole system is actually spinning around the intermediate axis. But how bad can that be? I mean, the minimum moment of inertia was somewhat unstable given enough time. Surely the intermediate axis is a bit more stable, right? No. The intermediate axis is bad, like really bad for stability. To prove this, I'll have you pause the video in a second and try to flip your phone. First, you want to do it in this direction, which is the maximum moment of inertia. Then try it in this direction, which is the minimum moment of inertia. And then try it like this, around the intermediate axis. So go ahead, pause the video and try that out. The first two seem stable. The minimal one is stable because there's not fluid sloshing around inside your phone, so it's not wasting kinetic energy very fast. But the third one, the intermediate axis, that one made your phone tumble. Try all you want, you're probably not going to get a full rotation without your phone starting to tumble, let alone two rotations, or the hundreds of thousands, possibly millions of rotations it would take you to get all the way to Mars. There's a great video of this on the space station using a T-handle, which looks pretty similar to Small Star's artificial gravity concept. This is a complex topic, but if you want to take a deep dive, I can recommend Veritasium's video. Derek gives the best explanation of this phenomenon that I've ever been able to find, and just like the last recommendation, I'll remind you of this at the end of the video. But for artificial gravity, we don't really care why this happens, we just want to avoid it. Unfortunately, this does mean that Small Star's concept is out purely based on the fundamental physics of rotation. The whole design was built around the idea of using the engines while spinning, but that's sort of unnecessary, and it would have to rotate in this direction anyway. This leaves us with one layout that's actually reasonable. You know, if you're willing to ignore short radius centrifuges, which are, hey, lighter, cheaper, and have a lot of good research backing them up. So the only concept that would work, definitely no other options, is two starships, tethered together. For some reason, the thought of tethered spacecraft is almost as scary to people as the thought of short radius centrifuges. As soon as you mention a tether, everyone immediately asks what happens when it breaks. First off, we have cables and tethers everywhere, and they don't just break without significant damage or corrosion. If we can land a rocket on Mars, I'm pretty sure we can build a rope. But just for you, I'll talk about what would happen if a tether broke. Let's consider that 500 meter radius to appease all the people that hate short radii. That was correlated with about 2 revolutions per minute. This means that as soon as a tether breaks, you're floating through space, rotating at 2 RPMs. Assuming that for some reason there's no safety system to stop the rotation, this creates a slight artificial gravity that's throwing you towards what should be the ceiling. Starship is about 50 meters tall, and we're just ballparking here, so let's assume the CG is right in the middle. The absolute worst case artificial gravity, if you're all the way up in the nose cone of the Starship, is about a tenth of a G. That's only 1/10 of the Earth's gravity, and about 2/3 of the Moon's gravity. If you're closer to the center, say the middle deck around here, that's only going to be 1/20 of a G. In both cases, it's pretty small and you can probably catch yourself fairly easily. So you'd probably survive the tether breaking, but the two ships have also been flung apart. Surely they're going off course. Well, we have math for that. Our 500 meter radius results in a tangential velocity of 100 meters per second. That's not slow, and it does need to be corrected. For context, the Perseverance rover only budgeted for about 13 meters per second of course corrections. However, in the context of an artificial gravity mission, this isn't actually that bad. You see, to start and stop the rotation, you already have to use the thrusters. You have to push the craft away from each other to keep tension on the tether, and you also have to push them sideways and accelerate them. And, of course, if you want to be spinning at 100 meters per second, you have to accelerate to 100 meters per second. And to stop rotating, you have to decelerate by the same amount. That means that just by the nature of the mission, you're already going to have enough fuel on board to deal with this scenario. In fact, if I was planning a Mars mission with a vehicle like this, I might intentionally break the tether to take advantage of that velocity. When you're getting close to Mars, you want to separate the vehicles so they don't land at exactly the same time. And you could even fine-tune the velocity by pulling in the tether or letting out a bit of slack. Now, it probably would be safer to just de-spin them normally, or have a system where they dock together, spin up, and then let out the tether, and then they retract and disconnect from each other when you're getting close to Mars, but that last one would require more fuel because you need a faster initial speed. You'd also be pulling more G's. Like, it's probably fine for the astronauts, but you need a stronger tether and structures in the vehicle. It's a whole mess. But the point I'm getting to is that if you're on an artificial gravity mission, you already have enough fuel to deal with this situation. So as far as the big artificial gravity concepts go, I'm definitely a fan of strapping a couple of starships together using these built-in lift points. But if I was actually in charge, I think you know I would just go with a small centrifuge inside the starship's cabin. The research is already looking promising, and the motion sickness is not all it's hyped up to be. Something like this is far safer, lighter, and cheaper, and more practical than any of the big alternatives. It just makes sense, no matter what YouTube comments say. And of course, here's your reminder to go check out Tom Scott's video where he visits an artificial gravity research facility. And you can also check out Veritasium's great video on the Intermediate Axis Theorem, as well as Small Star's original artificial gravity video. I made a playlist of all these videos up in the cards if you want to check that out. But for now, I'm Khan Hathi, and I'll see you in the next video.